Good afternoon, members. We have a quorum and it's the appointed time. I call to order the meeting of the Bills Committee on Social Workers Registration Amendment Bill 2024. Thank you for supporting my chairmanship. Agenda item number one, election of deputy chairman. The secretariat has issued a notice to members informing members that as at the deadline for nomination of deputy chairman, only one valid nomination has been received. Ms. Eunice Yong was being nominated. Her nomination was moved by myself and seconded by Mr. Jimmy Ng. According to Appendix 4 of the House Rules, I have to ask if members agree to the election of deputy chairman. Agreed. So now I declare Ms. Eunice Yong the deputy chair of our Bills Committee. Please come up to the stage. Agenda item number two, meeting with the administration. Would the clerk please ask the government officials to enter? With us today are Mr. Chris Sun, Secretary for Labor and Welfare, Mr. David Leung, Deputy Secretary for Labor and Welfare, Ms. Wong Ying Yi, Deputy Director of Social Welfare, Mr. Salvador Zhang, Senior Government Counsel, and Ms. Wendy Ho, Senior Government Counsel. Please refer to the Legislative Council brief sent to LegCo on the 14th of May by the LWB, that is paper LWBCR 45-2041/86, and a LSD report on the bill, that is LC papers LS 33/2024. Members may refer to these two sets of documents. Yesterday, I received a total of 64 submissions from deputations and individuals, and I directed the clerk to circulate the relevant submissions to members via email. I believe that you have all received it. And some of the submissions have been uploaded onto the LegCo website upon their consent. The administration will be giving us a consolidated response on the set submissions. I will ask Secretary Sun to walk us through the policy matters and the clauses, and then after that, we will go into clause-by-clause scrutiny. Dr. Tik Chi-yun has raised his hand. Dr. Tik, you're not a member of the BC. I will still allow you to speak. Thank you, Chairman. I know that we have received quite a number of submissions, and I'm not sure about the procedures. Will we be having a public hearing, or will we be informing the members of the public that they can submit submissions? Okay, we have to have the consent from members for us to organize a public hearing. Mr. Tommy Chang and Mr. Tang Kapiu have raised their hands. Mr. Tommy Chang, please. Thank you, Chairman. People around me, including LegCo members, are suffering from COVID. Without organizing a public hearing, we have already received 64 submissions. I think that it would be better for us to receive submissions instead of organizing a public hearing. I just organized a public hearing on the dentist registration bill. Actually, in the public hearing, only a few groups of people spoke, and they could only speak for 2 to 3 minutes. I think that as we already have 64 submissions, they will just be repeating what they said in the submissions during the public hearing, and I'm worried that there would be too many people concentrated in a single venue. I'm worried about the transmission of viruses. I think that over the past few years, people are used to submitting their views via emails or in written form, so I will not be supporting a public hearing. Mr. Tenkapio, unfortunately, I was not allotted a place in the Bills Committee, but I will still attach or be attending the meeting. I think that as there are 64 submissions that have been received, actually my party have submitted a submission. I believe that all 15 BC members would read all these submissions very carefully. If we are to organize a public hearing, we have to do it in July, and we have 9 new subcommittees starting their work very soon. I'm worried if we have enough conference room to use. I think that we should just have people write in. I think for social workers or non-social workers, they have channels for them to raise their views and convey their views to legislative members. So I don't think that there is a need for public hearing. Ms. Doreen Kong, I will see if there are other members who would like to speak on this matter of public hearing. If not, Ms. Doreen Kong will be last to speak on this. Thank you, Chairman. I've read the bill, and I think that the amendment is rather focused. CAP 505 is not a new ordinance. I don't think that we need to organize a public hearing. I think that we can just have people send emails to us to raise their views. Thank you. I think that most members agree that we don't have to organize a public hearing. When we received any submissions, then I will send those to all members and I will upload them onto the LegCo website so that people know about the views, and I will ask the administration to give us a consolidated response. Do we all agree? Mr. Tommy Chang. Thank you, Chairman. I agree with the arrangement. But can we have a deadline for submission so that government can give a consolidated reply after reading all the submissions? I think that we should set a deadline. For example, by 10th of June, we will stop receiving submissions. Mr. Cheng, I will try to be more relaxed with the arrangement. Even if we set a deadline and after the deadline we still receive submissions, I will still relay them to or refer them to the administration. I don't think that is very useful for us to set a deadline. I think that during our scrutiny of the bill, we have to take into account the submissions, even though we may have received it after the so-called deadline. Mr. Tenkapio, I don't think that we have to set a deadline. I'm chairing the Mandatory Reporting of Child Abuse Bill, and just now, the government just submitted a mandated reporter's guide, and after that, we received a large number of submissions, and I think that we still have to handle that and process those submissions. I think Mr. Cheng's suggestion is very good, but I think that we will be adopting a more flexible approach instead. Now, I will ask the Secretary to give us a brief presentation on the bill, and if members would like to speak, you can press the button now. For the first round, I will give each member 4 minutes, including question and answer. There are members who are not Bills Committee members who have pressed the button. I will still allow them to speak. Secretary, Thank you. Social Workers Registration Amendment Bill 2024. It is tabled before you. It is to improve the governance of the Social Workers Registration Board so that they act in the interest of public and to promote the development of the social worker profession. Currently, CAP 505 empowers the registration board to handle registration disciplinary matters of the social workers. The board exercises statutory power. They have the duty to safeguard national security, and they have to act in public interest. On the 15th of June, we briefed the panel on welfare services on the bill. All members of the panel supported the bill, and I'm glad to learn that the social worker sector and the LegCo support the bill, including some members of the board. They also support the amendments. There are two main parts to the amendment. I will briefly explain them. First, we will be expanding the membership of the board. We propose to raise the number of members from 15 to 27. However, the social workers will still make up a majority of the board. Currently, out of the 15 members, at least 8 of them are social workers. We propose to increase the number of members of the board to 27, and we will still stipulate in the laws that at least 14 should be social workers out of the 27 members. So in terms of ratio, social workers will still make up of a majority of the board. But as for how the social workers will be appointed, that will be changed. After the amendment, there will be still 8 members of the board that will be elected among social workers, but 17 will be appointed. We want to have a more diverse participation of the board so that we can introduce more voices into the Social Workers Registration Board. Apart from this, after expanding the membership of the board, we will be introducing prominent personalities from different sectors of the community so that the board will actually act in public interest and that there will be a broader and more balanced participation. Second, RSWs, registered social workers that have been convicted of serious offenses, will no longer be able to practice. Currently, social workers will have their licenses renewed annually. And if a social worker have committed a serious offense just right after their licenses are renewed, we can only remove their names after we can only remove their names when they renew their licenses. So for RSWs that have been convicted of serious offense, we will be putting in place a new mechanism for prompt removal of their names from the register. There are 2 tiers to the serious offenses. First, Schedule 2 offenses, including murder, indecent assault, child abuse offense endangering national security. These cases must be handled immediately. Second, offenses that may bring the profession into disrepute, and the offense is punishable with imprisonment. These offenses are not explicitly set out in the law. When RSWs are convicted of such offenses, the board will have to determine if their names should be removed. Third, we will be empowering the Secretary of Labor and Welfare to set out the code of practice. Currently, the arrangement is not clear. It only says that a notice will have to be published in the Gazette, but it doesn't designate who should be publishing the Gazette. Now, after the amendment, the code of practice will only take effect when the Secretary of Labor and Welfare publish a notice in the Gazette. Second, on the effective date of appointment, again, currently is not very clear in terms of the arrangement. After the arrangement, the appointment will only be effective when the direct DCP publish a notice in the Gazette.
there's also a setting of comprehensive professional development requirement for social work profession, and when they conduct the continuous professional development, and if in the future a social worker does not fulfill this requirement, there will be an arrangement for dealing with that, and that is the Fourth Amendment. And fifth, whether they are returned by election or appointed, before they take up the post, they have to take an oath to pledge their allegiance to the Hong Kong SAR of the PRC. This is necessary because they are exercising authority, and before they take up the post, we feel that it is necessary for them to take an oath. In addition, after they take up their post, if any member contravenes the oath, the CE can announce a vacancy because they have contravened the oath. I'd also like to take this opportunity to talk about some technical amendments. First of all, the board has a quorum. It's 6 people now, and we suggest that it be increased to 10. So you'll see that we have not changed the proportion. We have now 6 out of 15 being the quorum, roughly 40%. In the future, there will be 27 people on the board, and we add the quorum to 10. It's roughly 40% as well. And second, the registration board can require the chairman to be present. Currently, we have a quorum of 8 people. And if we have 8 people, then the chairman can convene the meeting. So in the future, the quorum will be increased from 8 to 10. That's because we have increased the number of board members. And third, the authority and rules of procedure, if it will not be affected if there is any vacancy. So even if there is a vacancy, the board business and operations will not be affected. And fourth, we have an interim measure. So when the laws take effect, the chairman and vice chairman, we also have a fifth arrangement where when the legislation commences, the new board, and within 21 days of returning a new member, they have to convene their first meeting. And sixth point, it's in the amendment, it's required that members return by election. If there is any vacancy, then the board needs to come to a decision. First of all, whether they will have a re-election. If they decide that they need a new election, they have to decide when the election will be held and how it will be held. But the laws will be made very clear. If the term of the member, if the remaining term does not exceed a certain time period, they don't need to be, they don't need a re-election. And the disciplinary committee panel, whether we only have 2 members in the disciplinary hearing. In the future, there will be 3 members. And we also have other technical amendments. We repeal some out-of-date clauses. So, Chairman, we are willing to answer any questions arising in the later part of the meeting. So we have 13 members who wish to speak. Let me read out their names. 4 minutes, including Q&A. Lam So Wai, Kenneth Leung, Reverend Canon Peter Douglas Kuhn, Stanley Lee, Tony Che, Chan Yong, Chan Pui Kang, Kok Wai Kang, So Chang Wang, Dick Ji Yun, Doreen Kong, Tommy Zhang, Yong Ho Yan, and Yim Kong, Miss Lam So Wai. Thank you, Chairman. I welcome the amendment of the board, increasing it to 27 and having the majority of them being social workers. I think that respects the profession and also ensures that we can introduce different voices. But the public do have some feedback. They are concerned that after the amendments, it would lead to an exodus So could you give us some details about the amendment and assuage our fears and concerns? Because honestly, there is a shortfall of social workers, not because of the amendment, but looking at the market yesterday, one of my junior colleagues just graduated. They have to take national security clauses now. So why would there be an exodus of social workers after the amendment? I'd like an explanation. So you want them to be more professional, and with the amendment, we have continuous professional development requirements. I support that. So as a as a social worker with undergraduate degree, we do encourage this professional development. So you should consider adding some registration requirements so as to enhance the professionalism of the industry, because currently there are people of different qualifications. Now, regarding currently, there is no emergency meeting requirement, and if they don't have a quorum, they have to adjourn. So if there is an emergency removal of registration and so on, will you have an emergency convening mechanism? Thank you, Ms. Lam Sowai. Now, we don't see that the amendment of this legislation will lead to an exodus of social workers. In fact, it might be the opposite. Because of this amendment, it will enhance the credibility of the industry. It provides a stable platform for development, and I think it is beneficial for social workers. So I don't see negative impact. And secondly, we will authorize the board to handle continuous professional development, but we won't require all social workers to be undergraduates. Some are undergraduates, some are not. And we will continue with the existing arrangement. So we won't see any postponement. Now, the board will be increased to 27. We'll have sufficient manpower. And if you look at the quorum, we will increase it to 10. So we believe that if there's any need to convene a meeting, they can handle any emergency. So how will you explain your efforts? We've been working very hard, whether it's through legislative council or even other venues. We do explain clearly, especially to the social welfare sector. We are dealing with very focused issues. We have not changed registration requirements. We're using the existing arrangement. Mr. Kenneth Leung, thank you, Chairman. I'm very happy to participate in this bill. And as the government said, it is necessary to fine-tune social welfare registration. And I do have some follow-up. First, we see that if a social worker affects the reputation of the industry, it also says that if the board feels necessary, and if not exceeding 5 years, the registered social worker can be removed from the register. So does that mean that after conviction or after their breaching of their professional rules, can they be suspended for 5 years? Is the maximum 5 years? That's a technical question. Second, I support the oath-taking arrangement because as a statutory body, the members need to pledge allegiance to SAR and uphold the basic law. So I'd like to ask, when the disciplinary committee panel, will they require the members also have to take a pledge? Well, the first question I'll have my colleague respond, and second is question is about oath taking. Now, it just requires that 27 registered members of the board. If DCP members do not need to take a pledge. Now, the TCP, they are members of the board, and when they've taken the pledge, they understand they need to uphold the basic law and pledge allegiance to the SAR. So, we will not have the concerns that we currently have. Regarding the first question, for any particular offense and the board decides to remove their membership for 5 years, so let's say 5 years later they return to become a social worker, but they commit another serious offense, then they can suspend this registration for another 5 years. So you have suspended their registration for 5 years and they make a new application. Will they receive a new registration or will they continue to be suspended? Or will they be permanently removed from the register? Well, if they had been suspended and that social worker makes a new application, then we'll have to see, the board will have to consider the situation and requirements at that time. So that means, so 5 years later, they seek a new application and the board will decide whether a new membership will be granted. Now, if they committed further offenses, we'll see if they get another 5 year suspension. Yes, that is the case. Reverend Kuhn, I have a comment and a question regarding Annex 2, the existing national security offenses according to the current legislation. Now, if they have contravened that, then all the board members, if they are in the consensus, they can remove the registration. So it seems that, well, is that too lax? Because in my understanding, if there's a contravention of national security, there is a permanent suspension of registration. So could you clarify that for me? And second, I previously mentioned that I want the government to consider whether the chairman be appointed. Why do I insist? Because in the coming future, the Social Welfare Registration Board needs to have its house put in order. So having a respected member does not mean that they are good, have good administrative skills. They might not have good communication skills and so on. So when they're appointed, especially in the early period when they need to implement some policies, we might run into some difficulties. That is my opinion. Thank you, Reverend Kuhn. The first issue about Annex 2, we have four types of offenses that are considered serious. One, murder, sexual offenses, child abuse, and national security. So first three, starting from 97, we've already had mechanisms dealing with that. Well, national security was only included in 2022. So when it's included in Act 2 and they're using the existing arrangement, when people commit these offenses, they should be removed permanently. But there is a backdoor when the board unanimously decides that they should be given a second chance, they can do so. But that is a very small chance, but there is a possibility. So I see Reverend Kuhn mentioned this, and the government needs to have a second thought about that. Do we need, when we amended Annex 2, we had We did not make any changes to the principal legislation. Now, we'd like to hear members' views. If everybody feels that there's a breach of national security, then they should not be given a second chance. We are willing to revisit this and see whether we can make some CSAs. But I'll have to consult the committee members. The second question is about the chairman.
We think that as the chairman and deputy chairman of the board are elected among social workers currently, we think that we should keep the practice. And under the reconstituted board, a fresh election will have to be conducted. And after the bill has been passed, the chairmanship and deputy chairmanship will be vacated, and the first meeting must be convened within 21 days upon passage of the bill. And in that first meeting, they have to elect afresh the chairperson and the deputy chairperson. We think that with 27 members in the board, with diverse and balanced participation, a respectable chairperson and deputy chairperson will be elected. Reverend Kuhn raised a very important point. If a member or RSW commits an offense endangering national security, should we be giving them a second chance and allow them to be re-registered as a social worker? I would like to ask members to think about this very carefully. And I hope that by the end of the work of this bill's committee, we have a consensus and we can make relevant proposals to the government. Next, Mr. Chen Yong. Thank you, Chairman. The sector and electors that I represent all support the amendment to the Social Workers Registration Ordinance. They said that it should have been done earlier. We have experienced some turmoil in 2019. Very often, people are convicted of an offense before they lose their license. I think that for social workers, they help the underprivileged. We need to impose a higher standards on them. And we have some examples where social workers who have been undergoing legal proceedings on offense endangering national securities become a member of the DCP. For US and Europe, they wouldn't allow this to happen. I would like to stress this. Offense endangering national security is a serious offense, and we should not be giving the offenders a second chance. I have a very strong view on that. Also, there are different kinds of criminal offenses under Schedule 2, and for offense endangering national security, it is separately set out in another schedule in some other countries. Shouldn't we create a separate schedule including this offense endangering national security separately? Thank you, Secretary. Thank you, Mr. Chen Yong, for your support of our work. For Schedule 2, in 2022, we included the offense of endangering national security in the schedule. We talked to the DOJ. Mr. Chen's observation is very correct. For other offenses under Schedule 2, including murder, assault, sexual offenses, child abuse, they are very detailedly set out, but that's not the case for offense endangering national security. That was just a very broad description, and that was done intentionally because offense endangering national security does not only cover safeguarding national security ordinance of the Hong Kong SAR. Offenses other than those set out under safeguarding national security ordinance may also endanger national security, and such offenses may evolve with the times, and as a result, DOJ asked us to draft the offense in such a way. And as for the actual operation, we rely on the board. The first thing that we think that the board is not doing right is that we have been asking the board to implement a mechanism. And we ask the board to take concrete action to ensure the effective implementation of the notice, that is to add an offense endangering national security to Schedule 2. We don't think that there's any issues with the schedule, but the board is not acting, and that's the problem. I propose that we keep Schedule 2 as it is, because it was drafted after much thought. Thank you. Next, Mr. Tony Chai. Thank you, Chairman. I think that social workers are very important because they help the underprivileged and help them solve issues in their lives. And the government have dedicated much resources on the sector. And they've given training to, for example, social workers. I am a professional myself. I represent the architect, the surveyors. For professions such as lawyers and accountants, they are different from social workers. It seems that the community does not really recognize the professionalism of social workers. I think that it is right for us to reconstitute the Social Worker Registration Board, because that would help the social workers so that we can enhance their credibility and professionalism. As for the composition of the board, well, I used to be a chairman of the Hong Kong Institute of Surveyors. There are two things about the members of the institute. They're mostly appointed by the chief executive, including the chairperson and the deputy chairperson. I see that the administration has been respecting the board. They try to fine-tune their operations whenever possible. But I also agree with what Reverend Peter Kun said. Because the positions of chairperson and deputy chairperson are very important, and I think that the government should have a say in the appointment. So to a certain extent, the government respects the board as long as they are operating in a normal manner. As for real estate authority, or estate agent authority, their composition has been stated very carefully and clearly. As for the Social Workers Registration Board, even after reconstitution, social workers will still make up a majority of the board. For Travel Industry Council and Estate Agent Authority, their board make up not of a majority of their practitioners. They make up of, most of the members are of their boards are lay members. So I have a question. The conduct and discipline of the practitioners are very important. We have disciplinary hearings and a DCP in the board. Have we looked at the membership of the DCP? Of course, I don't want to see practitioners undergoing disciplinary hearing, but I wonder if the government will consider increasing the number of members in DCP, because a disciplinary hearings takes time. And I don't think people can accept the fact that they have to wait a long time for their case to be processed. Secretary, thank you. In terms of number of members, there are two parts to the issue. for social workers who have been convicted of serious offenses under Schedule 2. The board will direct the immediate removal of those people. As for disciplinary hearing, your observation is very right. For disciplinary hearings, the cases can only be processed in hundreds of days. And I think that this is not proper. So after the amendment, for people who have been convicted of serious offenses, they don't have to go through disciplinary hearings. The board will be directing the removal of those people from the register. As for other offenses, the board will handle those. But we believe that after reconstitution, the time taken for handling disciplinary cases can be sped up and shortened. You may still ask for a second and third round, so please leave enough time for the government officials to respond to your question. Next, Mr. Stanley Lee. The Registration Board, as a statutory body, and is financially independent. And it seems that they are striving for independence from the government. I think that the paper submitted by the government is written very carefully, and it's very targeted. They have given us directions for improving the composition and the practice of the board. I, of course, support the bill, but I have some questions. As the Secretary said, after the board has been reconstituted, social workers will still make up a majority of the membership. I'm glad to hear that because I'm taking a course on social work. But I wonder how the government select which social worker or person to be appointed as a member of the board. I do think that the RSW should undergo CPD courses. And in the paper, it is said that the government will empower the board to create a CPD framework. So I wonder what the framework would be like. We have a we're scrutinizing the mandatory reporting of child abuse bill. I wonder if we can accord the CPD credits to social workers who have undergone relevant courses. Also, on oath taking, the members of the board will only have to sign a prescribed form and return it to the board. And there is also mention of whether the person genuinely and truthfully intend to uphold the basic law and so on and so forth. But you're just asking them to sign the form at their home. They could be swearing as they're signing the form. Shouldn't we ask the member of the board to actually sign the oath or the prescribed form at the premises of the registration board? We have no way to know if they actually genuinely and truthfully uphold the basic law and bear allegiance to Hong Kong SAR. If they're just signing the form at home, they could be swearing at the same time. Thank you. Secretary.
Thank you, Mr. Stanley Lee. Let me answer your questions one by one. In the future, out of the 27 members of the board, there will be lay members coming from different sectors. As I've mentioned, we will be bringing in people from different sectors. It's hard for me to say what kind of professionals we are introducing into the board, but you may imagine that we will be asking accountants and lawyers to participate in the board to facilitate their works. Also, for professors, academia, teaching, social workers, social work or researching on relevant topics may participate in the board. We don't see such kind of personalities in the board currently. These scholars may help the board in formulating the CPD framework. The government will not be directing the board as to what the framework should look like. We will just empower the board to do so. As the social workers will still make up a majority of the board, well, of course, we hope that there will be esteemed social workers and scholars that will be elected by the sector to the board. And hopefully by this, when the board formulates the CPD framework, invaluable comments can be given.
Third is regarding the oath. They won't be taking the oath at home in a very casual manner. We will have a JP or another witness to witness them signing the oath. They cannot do it casually. There has to be a witness. We have to ensure that the whole procedure is solemn. Chan Puilang. Thank you, Chairman. I support the amendments to this bill, and the bill is also rather clear. My concern is, and has already been mentioned by colleagues, the registered social workers are a professional group, so the amendment requires that on this occasion they need continuous professional development. We also understand that this work will be authorized to, we will authorize the registration board to handle CPD, but just handing it over to the board and, but shouldn't we have a timetable, some sort of schedule? Because if they drag their feet and don't achieve anything, then the Policy Bureau should give them some sort of guideline. They need to attain certain requirements within, let's say, 5 years and so on. Second, regarding the paper, paragraph 10, we, under the new mechanism, we can remove social workers from the registration and so on. My understanding is that the registration lists can be published in the Gazette, and if they deregister, it can be done as well. So can we make it more transparent? How do we know, how can the public know if social workers have been deregistered? So the public needs better access to this information. Thank you, Chairman. I'll have my colleague take up the second question. The first question was about CPD and whether there should be a timetable for the registration board. Well, the law will not state so. It just says that in the future they will have a new function. They need to stipulate CPD. So we do not want to give a hard and rigid timetable, because to come up with a practical CPD, it cannot be done overnight. We understand there should be sufficient consultation, and we do believe that the industry, the majority of the industry, wish to have a framework for continuous professional development. But having the government set the timetable might not be a great idea. We can communicate with the industry. When the new registration board convenes, we can have more communication. And I believe the new registration board will want to implement CPD as soon as possible. But it has to depend on some practical approach and consensus. So we want to give the registration board sufficient space to do their work. We believe the new registration board, if they have the statutory authority, they don't want to drag their feet as well. We believe they can do their job. Just now, there was a question about if a social worker is deregistered, how will that information be disclosed? Now, after the amendment, it is required that the registration board will have to publish this information in at least one Chinese and English newspaper. And there should also, those are the basic requirements. The registration board can also publish this information in other publications or media. Mr. Kok Wai Kung, I was not included in this bill committee, but I'm concerned about this bill. That's why I'm here. Now, looking at the LegCo website, we have received quite a lot of support. A lot of social welfare groups have also written us. They have provided feedback as well. But looking at the Bills Committee membership, a majority of us are not social workers. So this reflects that society attaches a lot of importance to social worker registration, and we also are monitoring the work. We're monitoring the efficacy and how the government's money is spent. We want to form a working relationship with social workers and their clients. So social workers, clients, feedback should not be ignored. And today we've also heard from colleagues that we want to enhance the professional qualifications. So the government's intention to make these amendments is because we have some 5 technical amendments. So in these are actually mild amendments. Now, even if you increase the membership of a board to 27 and having more than 50% being social workers, Chairman, I am concerned about CPD. It doesn't have a timetable, a schedule. Just now, the secretary had made some responses that he wants the registration board to have some flexibility. But we do see that a lot of social welfare organizations have their own in-house training. So we should vet these courses to see if they meet CPD requirements, because social welfare covers a lot of aspects. The elderly, children, and they need different kinds of training. So if we want to convene all the stakeholders, I think that would take too long. So I do have a suggestion. And looking at the social worker registration website, there's some information there that says registration board has conducted some studies, and these are dated studies. 2011, 2013, they asked whether they agree on having CPD. Now, I do note a scenario that in the 2013 survey, 450 plus organizations, there were only 66 responses out of the 450 plus organizations. So I would like to remind the new registration board, whether they do it on their own initiative, that the registration board should have greater communication with the social welfare organizations. They need more information to enhance social welfare, social worker professional qualifications. That's a suggestion from Mr. Kotwaika. Secretary, do you wish to respond? Well, thank you, Mr. Kotwaika, for your opinion. Now, we believe that with the new registration board, they will implement the CPD as soon as practicable. And when we have more respected members in the board, their communication with social welfare organizations would be vastly improved. Dr. So Chang-wing, I just want to state my position. If the old registration board has a lot of shortfalls, then this amendment has been anticipated for a long period of time. It has been highly anticipated. So I support enhancing the membership, having more participation, and we also need to enhance the qualifications and the professionalism of social workers, and there also should be a removal mechanism from the registration. Now, just now, the secretary said that if they are serious offenses, there will be an immediate disciplinary committee panel hearing, and they can be deregistered. Now, if, let's say, before the person has been convicted, can they be deregistered? Because we know that there has been an offense, and if they continue to be appointed as a social worker, it's because they have not been convicted. I have a question about this arrangement. Second, the secretary has spoken to the media previously. It is not, the amendment is not to restrict previously convicted persons from contributing. In fact, there have been ex-convicts who have been, after release, they have contributed to society. So, what are the thresholds or restrictions for ex-convicts to work as social workers? So, what mechanism, what vetting mechanism do you have for ex-convicts who wish to participate in social welfare, to participate in the social welfare workplace? Thank you, Dr. So. There are two questions. They are related. Currently, the existing deregistration and the amendment will allow for an immediate deregistration. The principle is the same. The requirements are the same. What does that mean? Well, if the social worker commits Annex 2, Schedule 2, that is murder, sexual assault, child abuse, and national security offenses, it is an immediate deregistration and permanent deregistration. But for a lower level offense, after they committed the offense, the registration board feels that, well, this behavior brings about a negative impact to the reputation of the whether they are convicted to a jail sentence or not, that's not a requirement. They have to be deregistered. Well, They could be deregistered permanently or not more than 5 years. So that is up to the board's discretion. Now, I want to emphasize that social worker registration, it is unique. It is different from other professions. They do allow for people who have committed an offense to allow them to be social workers. We understand and respect this principle, but we have not changed. This principle has not been altered. The question we have is that how the registration board handle or exercise its discretion. We feel that the current board is not doing its job appropriately. Put simply, we do have some dubious cases, and that leads to some concern. So for ex-convicts, it's not fair as well, because the public wishes to see the registration. They have to do their job, and you have to be sure that they have committed offense a long time ago, but they have turned over a new leaf and they can be a good social worker, and they ought to be given a chance rather than the current arrangement. We're afraid of this poor image. So through this amendment, when the registration board is reconvened, when they exercise their discretion, they can do a better job, and they can also take care of public interests. So I just want to explain a little bit more.
Dr. Tik Chi-yun, thank you, Chairman. Secretary, we all know what the roles of social worker is in society. Your bureau also rely on social workers to carry out their works. Upon implementation of this lump sum grant mechanism, the morale of social workers have deteriorated. We want to boost the morale of the sector. We uphold just one word, that is professionalism. We want to help the registration board play their roles so that social workers can give full play to their potentials. I've been talking to my friends in the sector, and they told me that the board is not actually promoting the professionalism of the sector and that we should do more. But there are also people who are worried that the government is intervening into the profession by appointing so many members to the board. Secretary, I agree with some arrangements. I believe that after amendment, the composition of the board will be diversified, balanced, and professional. So I think that in terms of appointment of members, as I've suggested, please appoint professors of universities and credible professionals in the sector, as well as representatives from professional bodies to the board. If we can do that, we can have the support of the sector. Also, I would like to seek some clarifications. 14 out of the 27 members will be registered social workers, and out of those 14 social workers, 8 will be elected and 1 will be a public officer, and the rest of the 5 will be appointed, I believe. Altogether, there will be 14 registered social workers. So for the registered social workers, that is public officer, will that person be tilting in favor of the government? That's a question. So I propose this composition of 8 plus 6. Will the government consider this? On CPD, I agree with what the other members said. I think it's great for the secretary to allow for some flexibility with the board, but with a regulated CPD framework that will facilitate the professional development of the sector. I hope that the revamped board will undertake that they will create a CPD framework and they will give the community a timetable. I will write to them later. I think that apart from allowing flexibility for the board, they will have to respond to the community. Secretary, thank you. I don't think that the board is being intervened by the executive. After the revamped board, the board's been revamped, the social workers will still make a majority of the membership. But as to how we appoint members, there should be different ways. And under the current board, the registered social workers are one-sided. Some respectable professionals, scholars, elites who have served the community for a long time are currently unable to join the board. This is not conducive to the development of social workers sector. We need to show that after amendment of the ordinance, we can have a more balanced, professional, and diverse participation in the board, especially when the board will have to take forward the CPD mechanism. So through the reconstitution of the board, we want to introduce respectable professionals into the board so that they can give professional advice to not just the current social workers, but also on the continuous professional development of the sector. I think that the board should be empowered to set out a timetable and a framework on their own. And I think that the revamped board will carry out their statutory duties as soon as possible. Under the laws, at least 14 of the members should be social workers. But what we mean by at least 14 is that there could be more than 14 social workers that are members. Out of these 14 members, 8 are elected, 1 is the director of social work, and 1 public officer. We have 6,000 colleagues in the social welfare department. And actually, out of the 20,000 social workers in Hong Kong, some 6,000 are working in the social welfare department. We have 27,000 social workers in Hong Kong, and a large portion of them are working for the social welfare department. So I don't think that is not reasonable for us to appoint a public officer as a member of the board or to be a member of the board. Ms. Doreen Kong, please. Thank you, Chairman. Just now, Reverend Kuhn talked about if we should give people who have committed offenses under Schedule 2 a second chance. I thought about this and I've taken a look at the offenses under Schedule 2. I don't think that we should give people who have committed offenses under Schedule 2 a second chance. Currently, social workers don't just have to uphold the professionalism. I've actually read relevant documents in the mainland and other countries. It's actually about competence instead of conduct. Schedule 2 offenses are serious offenses. Social workers committing these offenses actually show us that they are not of good character and they have bad values. And that actually affect the underprivileged people that they serve. When a social worker is incompetent, the harm that it brings would be very significant. When a medical doctor treats someone wrong, then someone could die. But the same goes for social workers' clients. The harm caused to their clients could also be irreversible. So I don't think that we should be giving people or social worker committing Schedule II offenses a second chance. The trust is not just between social workers and their clients. We need the entire community to trust the social workers for the sector to move forward and develop. Second, on the oath-taking arrangement, I may speak for the second round on this matter, and I may need the DOJ to assist me. I read through the bill. It could be affidavit or affidation, but we rarely call them written oath. My last comment. If the member does not return the oath in written form or prescribed form, they may still be reappointed as a member of the board after 5 years. I don't agree with the arrangement, because if someone does not respect the basic law, we shouldn't allow them to continue to be a registered social worker, because that reflects their values. Thank you, Secretary. Thank you, Ms. Doreen Kong. As for Schedule II offenses, whether we should allow people committing such offenses to have a second chance. As we are amending the ordinance, we want to take this opportunity to hear from members what they think. Schedule II offenses are very serious offenses. There's no question about that. But some 20 years ago, when we created this schedule, we had some different views. We were of the view that we should give these registered social workers a second chance. This second chance is, well, it's very hard to come by, because we need all members of the board to resolve otherwise for a person convicted of Schedule II offenses to be re-registered. The government keep an open mind to any amendments as time have changed. If majority of the community and members think that we should be amending the Schedule II and the relevant arrangement, we will be happy to accept such an opinion. So there are three options. First, we could keep the current arrangement. Second, we should not be giving people committing Schedule II a second chance. And third, maybe we can just not give a second chance to people who commit offense endangering national security. For the oath, it has to be taken in a written form. For oath-taking arrangement for civil servants, it's also done in a written form. But as for details, I can ask the DOJ to elaborate. For people who don't meet the oath-taking requirement, they cannot become a member within 5 years after expiry date of the period specified for returning the signed board member oath. I think that the same goes for the election ordinance for district council and LegCo. We just make reference to their practice for this 5 year limit. Who will take the question? Law draftman? Or Mr. Zhang? Thank you. As mentioned by the Secretary, the civil servants are taking oath by returning a prescribed form. So what is the mechanism for the social worker registration board? We do have a prescribed form setting out the details of the oath.
It requires a JP and a practicing lawyer, solicitor, to bear witness. And they need to pledge and fill in a written declaration. And that would be considered an appropriate manner of pledging. So when this form is handed back to the government, this is what our written pledge requirement is on this occasion. Mr. Tommy Jung, I'd like to highlight a few issues before I ask my question. First of all, for those of us with a longer experience in the council, we understand the social worker's position and political stance, but we're not talking about that today. I also would like the secretary to be unfairly criticized as interfering. I can see in CU our dental legislation, we see that arising a lot of times. Well, professionalism isn't everything. We cannot hide behind that. What is there to hide from? If you ask me, I'm thinking along the same lines as Reverend Kuhn. When you appoint chairman, it's not an issue of respect or not respect. 25 years ago, the Chinese culinary school president was also appointed. What's the problem with that? It doesn't mean that we are not respecting the profession. So when we appoint a chairman, and recently in Chinese U, our vice chancellor were appointed. What's the problem? I think we need to revisit this issue. I support the appointment of chairman. Now, in Annex 2 backdoor, I do have some views on that. Even though you say the probability of that occurring is very low, but if you insist because you're afraid of criticism, well, I hope that in the future this backdoor voting is, it can be conducted by secret ballot, because otherwise they would be under pressure, especially for the director. The director can always say that the government wants you to do so, but in order to be fair, these ballots, if they are to be held, it should be a secret ballot. But of course, I do not support Annex 2, so that's all I have to say. How do we proceed? We can have a further discussion. Well, thank you, Mr. Jung. The so-called backdoor escape, we require a unanimous decision, but it's not spelled out in the legislation whether it is by ballot or secret ballot. But you can see that it's a very stringent requirement. It has to be arrived via consensus. And we also heard from Reverend Kuhn and Mr. Chung whether the chairman should be returned by election or appointed by the government. Well, we'll have to hear your views. Now, we have proposed returning the social worker registration board chairman by election. and the election committee will elect their own chairman and vice chairman. So we propose upholding the existing arrangement. But of course, we do respect your views. When we reach that point in clause by clause, we can see whether members have decided times have changed and we need a new approach. Well, put simply, I cannot put forward my position right now. I just want to say that there is an advantage of having an appointment by CE. They can be highly respected, and it's hard to decline the CE. But having a chairman being elected, there are different considerations. So I think for the social worker registration board to benefit, they should have an appointment. Now, I think on this occasion, we can enhance the credibility of social workers, especially the public's trust in social workers. And how do we have further trust in the registration board? Our membership has changed. The number of members has increased. We have more diverse membership. I agree with that. And regarding the oath-taking requirement, I also agree with that. And we've also heard the background for these amendments, because we have people who have been convicted of serious crimes and they have been had their registration renewed. So I would like to ask, how many have been convicted of serious crimes, have been sentenced, and have also renewed their social worker registration? Because we see the existing laws. In Clause 24, there's a requirement that the registered social worker, they need to disclose their conviction record. So I want to ask if they, in light of the law, if they have not disclosed their conviction, and if they have disclosed their conviction and the registration board continues to approve their application, is there any way for us to know if their application has been renewed? If these people do not disclose the information, is there any penalty mechanism to penalize these social workers who seek a renewal of their registration? But for existing problems, how do we take the next step forward? How will the registration board handle that in the future? Will there be any penalty? How will the government deal with the registration board before the amendment? Can we have more immediate, permanent deregistration? We have a group of people who have convicted of Annex II offenses and are still registered social workers. So I think the government has the responsibility to disclose this information. And the second question is about Schedule 2. All, whether it's rape or sexual offense, and now you've also included national security offenses. So if there's no backdoor, then we should do away with Schedule 2. But if you do want to classify the offenses, I'd like to hear how you differentiate between them. Thank you for your questions. Regarding Schedule 2, as I said, we're willing to discuss with the Bills Committee. It seems that Schedule II national security offenses should be handled separately. They should have deregistration. There should not be a backdoor for them. Or for all offenses in Schedule II, there should be no backdoor. Or we can have further discussion. We can find a outcome that meets all our expectations. Now, previously I mentioned a lot of shortcomings in the registration board. For example, as the vice chairman said, if they've been convicted, it doesn't have to be serious crime. There might be different breaches. Now, my understanding is they have to report themselves. I don't see a stringent discovery approach, so that is a shortcoming. You are correct. I don't see where they have a mechanism to see whether there was full disclosure, whether people have disclosed their convictions. And previously I mentioned serious offenses are still registered. They have renewed the application. We're now seeking for more information from registration, but we don't have it yet. Well, you can see the newspapers will publish who has a serious offense and who is still a social worker. We have more than a dozen cases from the past few years. Using the simplest method, we can refer to newspapers and see how many social workers have committed serious offenses. We don't have this information. This information is held by the registration board. And since our last meeting, we wrote to the registration board seeking this information, but they have not responded. Now, as secretary, I can tell you, I think there are serious shortcomings. This is a statutory requirement. The social workers need to disclose whether they have been convicted of serious offenses. There has to be a strict approach. So we feel that there's an immediate need for amendment. When we have so many people joining, they have to comply with the law. This is nothing new. This is existing. We need them to comply to enhance the credibility of the registration board so that we can have faith in the registration board. Actually, after the amendment, how will the government ensure that the new registration board will go through the registration? Because I don't see that they have been authorized to do so. How will you conduct that? Now, the social workers have to register every year. They need to renew their registration every year. There is a legal requirement. The shortcoming is that the registration board has not exercised its authority. They have deviated from the spirit of the law. So after the convening of the new registration board, they should do their job. And I believe that they will have more manpower. They will have more respected members and other professional members. They will help the registration board do their job. Mr. Yim Gong. Thank you, Chairman. Social workers are an important element in society. They help stabilize society. The amendments, I support the current amendments. We want the social workers to play a greater role in the future. So for those who have committed serious offenses, they need to be deregistered immediately. But if they have only committed moderate offenses, such as fighting, theft, these, even though they might not be Schedule II offenses, but it still has a negative impact. So if social workers need to serve as a role model, then if there's a negative impact on, but if it's not a Schedule II offense, then should they be suspended I'd like members to look into this and see whether they should be deregistered. So I suggest there should be a suspension mechanism.
Also, given the current international political situation, some countries may be subject, some other countries may jail Hong Kong or Chinese people because of offenses endanger national security. Because we have some colleagues working in our London office that have been arrested because of endanger national security offenses there. Will social workers subject to such a political tactics be, have their license removed in Hong Kong? For those people who have been imprisoned because of their offenses, they may be able to turn a new leaf after being discharged from prison. We should give them another chance instead of pushing them on the road of antisocial. Secretary, but this is not a new arrangement. After passage of the bill, there are three levels to the mechanism. For social workers who have committed Schedule II offenses, including murder, sexual assault, rape, offense endangering national security, abduction of child or juvenile, for those social workers committing such crimes and offenses, the board can direct the removal of such social workers from the register permanently unless we provide for a backdoor. For other offenses that may bring the profession of social worker into disrepute and the offense is punishable with imprisonment, the board will have to decide on whether they should remove the social worker who have committed such offenses permanently or for a shorter period, not exceeding 5 years. For even more moderate kind of offenses, as mentioned by Mr. Yim, the offenses may not be punishable with imprisonment. We still have to handle such cases. When there's complaints, perhaps the board will convene a disciplinary hearing, a disciplinary committee will be established to handle such complaints. So there are three layers to the mechanism. For social workers committing offenses in other jurisdictions, how should we handle them? Deputy Secretary, Mr. Yim is saying that if a social worker has committed sexual to offenses in other jurisdictions, then how should we deal with them? Well, as far as I understand, for social workers who have committed offenses that is comparable to Schedule II offenses in Hong Kong, the board may still deregister such social workers. We have finished with our first round. Tony Che, Kenneth Lan, Tik Chi Yun, Stanley Lee, and Doreen Kwong would like to ask or speak for the second round. Is there any other members who would like to speak for the second round? If not, each member will have 4 minutes. Thank you. Mr. Tony Che. Thank you, Chairman. I think that the Secretary should take a more determined approach in changing things up for the Social Workers Registration Board. After passage of the bill, it seems that the Secretary is very confident in the reconstituted board. It seems that the Secretary is allowing the board to determine anything. and everything. I think that the government should consider appointing chairperson and deputy chairperson to the board. For the CBD arrangement, of course, I agree with that. We need the board to determine the framework, and I think that's okay for you to trust the board in formulating the CPD framework and requirements. But as for the appointment of chairperson and deputy chairperson, I think that the secretary should seriously consider having the chief executive appoint those two positions. As for the positions of register, the relevant provisions have not been amended. That is Section 25 under the ordinance. Will we be giving more power to the registrar? Secretary. Thank you. Reverend Kun, Mr. Tony Che, and Mr. Tony Che all talked about the appointment of a chairperson and deputy chairperson of the reconstituted board. Should the chairperson and deputy chairperson be elected among the sector, or should the government appoint the chairperson and deputy chairperson? As I mentioned, we don't have a very firm stance, and we will be listening to members. However, we think that the current arrangement of election is proper, but if the members think that the government should be having a stricter or a bigger control over the board, I will accept that and I will consider such a suggestion. As for the membership of DCP, well, the board will be tasked to identify members to sit on the DCP, and we think that the current board is not actually carrying out their duties very properly. After the board has been revamped, we are confident that with the more diverse and balanced participation, they will be able to identify suitable members to sit on the DCP. We will not be amending the provisions on registrar. That's actually a staff member of the board. The registrar is not a civil servant, and the board will be the one hiring the registrar. The registrar is just a screw, and the registrar carry out administrative duties. Chairman, I want to stress that it seems that the secretary is very confident in the reconstituted board upon passage of the bill. I think maybe we can have the secretary recommend someone to become a chairperson and deputy chairperson of the board. I think that by recommending a person, we would have respected the views of the members of the board. As for the requirements and duties of the registrar, of course, the Director of Social Welfare is a member of the board. After passage of the bill, they can convey their views. But I think the secretary can be can be more aggressive in the amendment. Well, I think your view is very clear. Next, Mr. Kenneth Leung. Thank you. I agree with what Mr. Tony Che said. It seems that the government is being very tolerant, and the government is looking forward to having the reconstituted board carry out the duties and improve the governance. The government have placed a lot of confidence in the reconstituted board. But as to how we identify social workers who have committed serious offenses, we don't have a mechanism to do that under the bill. For social workers who need to renew their license, we will ask them to disclose if they have committed any offenses. But as for the form of registration renewal that I have at my hand, the form is just asking the applicant to declare if they have committed any offense. We don't have to ask any lawyer or JP to countersign. A As for new application, I know that there is such a requirement, but for renewal, there is not such a requirement. If this is the mechanism, how do we plug the loophole? So should we just give our full confidence in the reconstituted board? Will there be any guidelines to be set by the government and ask, for example, as establish a list of tasks for the board members to do in the future? Secretary, thank you. As I've said time and again, we have high expectations for the reconstituted board because currently the board is not carrying out their duties conferred upon them by the laws. For renewal of licenses, the social workers have to declare if they have committed serious offenses or criminal offenses. Currently, the board just asks them to make self-declaration, but I think that the board should verify it. Some social workers have committed serious offenses and their cases are widely reported on the media and newspapers. The board currently don't have a mechanism to gather such information and to verify the self-declaration of the applicants. This is a statutory requirement for the board. And only when the board plays their gatekeeping role well will the public have confidence in social workers. The workload of the reconstituted board will be very substantial. That is why we will be increasing the number of members. They have to do some catch up, and I'm confident that the board will be able to carry out their duties duly after amendment of the bill. As we have all observed, there are a lot of shortcomings to the board currently. Dr. Tik Chi-yun, thank you. If we can have a broad balance and professional participation of the in the board, then we wouldn't have any questions. I think that we should be confident in the board. If not, we have to perhaps lay out all the requirements and restrictions for the board. I think that the secretary has struck a balance. Otherwise, the morale of the sector will be affected. Against such background, I don't think that the chairperson and deputy chairperson of the board should be appointed by the chief executive, as the board will become will have a broad and balanced participation. I think that we should have the social workers lead their own board. As for the composition of the board, well, we have to take into account public interest. So apart from appointment of social workers, we will be appointing lay members. I think that we should also include clients and users in the board as members because they will be able to speak on behalf of the public and users. My third question, as I've said, the sectors have questions regarding the bill. It's mentioned by the secretary. They will be explaining to the sector, and they have done it before. Can the secretary let us know what people said to you during the consultation, and what plans do the government have to enhance liaison with the sector? Secretary, thank you. Chairman, and thank you, Dr. Tik. As for the appointment of chairperson and deputy chairperson, I hear your views. As I said, we don't have a final or firm stance yet and think that we have to listen to all members before we make a decision. As for what people should be appointed or what who should become a member of the board, after revamp, there will be 27 members in the board. At least 14 will be social workers. There could be more than 14 in the future. But we undertake that we will find the most suitable and the best people to become members of the board. On explanation, we have organized some briefing sessions and
so we will provide a written communication to all our subvented organizations, and the amendment on this occasion is very focused. So I can say simply that the industry knows very clearly the purpose of the amendment, and we really want the governance issue to be resolved. We want to enhance social workers' professionalism. We do have difference of opinion. The difference of opinion is one issue, and not understanding is a separate issue. The social welfare community also support the amendments, because the amendment can set the registration board on the right track, and the public and the social worker community will benefit. Mr. Stanley Lee, I wish to continue on the oath-taking requirement. In Schedule 3, we do have a template for the oath, and we need a JP and practicing solicitor to witness. We understand that we have solicitors who have been convicted before. Do you still have faith in them? The registration board has 27 members, and these 27 people, if they have to be monitored, is that feasible? Because the amendment, aside from some practical amendments, we also want to enhance credibility of the board. The current board is bankrupt. They don't have any credibility anymore. And if we look at the returning process, some 8 members are returned by election. We don't know who they are. So the oath is very important. So once again, could the government look at how we can make the process more credible? Thank you, Mr. Lee, for the question. I fully understand your question. You want to ensure that the oath is sincere and credible. So, Chairman, perhaps I can suggest, when we get into clause-by-clause scrutiny, we'll go and look at this, and I cannot give you an immediate response. Now, I understand Mr. Stanley Lee is concerned that we need a JP or a practicing solicitor to act as a witness, the oath, and he might feel that this might not be the best arrangement. So that is a starting point. Since Mr. Lee has some concerns, we can look into this, and when we get into clause by clause, we can have a further discussion after our deliberation. Now, I think the Secretary has put forward a very practical solution. Ms. Doreen Kong, I do have some background information as a solicitor. Whenever we come across when we are convicted of criminal offenses, we have to be disbarred. There are a lot of careless driving cases where lawyers have been disbarred. So we need to strike a balance. We are not being overly stringent regarding social workers. Now, regarding Schedule 2, I'm very happy to see the secretary say that we need to balance public interest, but in Schedule 2, it covers a lot of serious offenses, including kidnapping, rape, murder, operating or soliciting. Now, if I communicate with my clients or with parents, it's hard to explain that there is a backdoor for social worker registration. Now, if the victims hear that, they would be very distressed. So I feel that when we have mandatory reporting of child abuse, we are very concerned about these offenses. So if you look at the logic of the legislation, there should not be any backdoor to escape deregistration. Now, thank you for your view. As I said before, we will listen to your views, and when we reach clause-by-clause scrutiny, we can provide the government's position. Thank you for providing food for thought. Ms. Slum, so white. I want to add that the registration board has to be reorganized. Now, I see in the past that there have been some feedback saying that there have been a lot of shortcomings. There have been 25 meetings without minutes of meetings, and there has no data statistics. Now, just now, the secretary said that we could search the internet to see if how many social workers have been convicted. So next month we'll have a new bunch of graduates. So if we have new registration, 600, 700 of them. Now, if I'm a social worker, I'm less known. Mr. Tikjun is more well known. Let's say person A is not well known, but he has been convicted, but nobody knows about it. So why do we have this reorganization requirement? So for recent graduates and new graduates, there's no impact on them when the registration board is reorganized. But there is a lot of bias right now. The 5 points you mentioned, there is a lot of covering up, and I would like this work to be sped up. Well, Ms. Lam has highlighted the shortcomings of the registration board. How do you respond? Well, she has provided some feedback, and thank you for the feedback. So we've exhausted the list. Mr. Tekjiun, do you have a third round? We've had a good discussion covering many perspectives, and there's some feedback. Can the registration board be more professional? And do we have room for improvement? So when the new registration board is convened, it can be more balanced and have more input. I hope that with the new board, we can resolve the issues. It is not... We need the social worker community to understand that they need more autonomy, they need to enhance professionalism. We're not criticizing them. I think the issues have been highlighted, and given today's meeting and feedback, everything is on record. So I think the new registration board will understand the tasks ahead of them. We should not place too many restrictions on them. Any response? No. Thank you for the feedback. Any other questions? If not, then we'll conclude the policy discussion. I think the next meeting we can conduct clause-by-clause scrutiny. Please note that the legal advisor, the 29th of May, has written a letter, and I hope the government can provide a written response to help us with the clause-by-clause scrutiny. Agenda item 3 is AOB. I'd like everybody to note that I've notified everybody of the future 3 meetings, the date and time. Next meeting is 4th of June, 4:30 to 6:30, 7th of June and 11th of June. And we do have other time slots for adequate discussion. And if there is no AOB, I conclude a meeting adjourned, and we can do clause by clause next meeting. Thank you, everybody.